Dear students, today we are going to learn about the chapter 5. It is clouds and rain, but we are emphasizing today on the precipitation, actually on the rainfall. So, the first and foremost, we have to study the hydrological cycle. Now, what is hydrological cycle? In the atmosphere, actually on the surface of the earth, there is several form of water which can be transformed into different form, shape and size. It could be in solid, it could be in liquid, or it could be in gaseous way. So all the form which is transforming in its way, all the form which is been changing from time immemorial, it is the part of hydrological cycle. The hydro is the water. So, as we could observe by different processes, it is in the part of hydrological cycle. If we could draw a diagram of hydrological cycle, then it will be clear to you. So here the main hydrological regime is been drawn. The regime describes that every area of the earth's surface has its specific process which are termed as number one is called evaporation. Number two is called evapotranspiration, and number three is called condensation. Fourth one precipitation. So these are some processes which is engaged whole of the hydrological cycle. The water is transforming its formation from one state to another. Firstly, we could observe that from the ocean lakes or rivers, whatever it is, the water in the liquid form is being changed into water vapor. The process by which the liquid is changing into the water vapor is called evaporation. It engages due to the insolation of the sun, due to the excessive heat of the sun, it is changing the water into the water vapor. That's why this arrow demarcates the evaporation. And the second one, which is evapotranspiration, as we all know, the transpiration is the process by which the plants gets, or plants is being evaporated, the water moisture molecules between the in the plants is being transformed into the water vapor, which is added to the atmosphere, is called evapotranspiration. So, transpiration and evaporation combinedly causes evapotranspiration. The action of the water particles of the water or anything like rainfall or something, precipitation, which is penetrating between the soil or within the soil, it is called as infiltration. The lowering of the water through the soil particles is called infiltration. But the opposite action, which is called the capillary action, and the water moves upward, is engaged in evapotranspiration. The water molecules or the soil moisture get sucked up by the plant roots and get transformed into the water vapor by transpiration. So all of the process, evaporation and evapotranspiration, get into the atmosphere by water moisture or water vapor. Then the process is called condensation, which actually forms clouds. The different types of clouds, which are going to be studied in the next video, in this chapter as well. It's the first part of the chapter. But in the same process, the condensation makes clouds. Different types of clouds are there. There will be high clouds, medium clouds, as well as low clouds, and vertical clouds as well. So the condensation makes the water vapor to coagulate with each other and get a formation of liquid particles as well. So all of the water vapor will be attached to each other by some of the agent. Now, what is the agent that is acting to form a cloud, which is called aerosols or suspended particulate matter, SPM. So if there is aerosol or suspended particulate matter in the atmosphere, then they are act like a binding agent to form the cloud. All of the water vapor, all the particles of the water vapor will attach to other by aerosol or suspended particulate matter. The fourth one is the precipitation. After the formation of the cloud, if there is a larger particles of water, or more than two or three water vapor condenses with each other, then they will form water droplets. As we all know, the cloud forms at the higher altitude. Increase in altitude, there is a decrease in temperature, which we would call normal lapse rate. So if there is a decrease in temperature, then the water vapor condenses to water droplet, and after a certain time, if it is get heavier, then by the gravitational force, it will fall on the surface of the earth. In the form, this process is called precipitation. It could be in the form of liquid, it could be in the form of crystal flakes, which is termed as hails, or as well as it could be termed as snowfall. In this altitude where the cloud generates, due to the sudden drop of the temperature, due to the release of the latent heat, the water vapor, when it coincides with each other, it forms crystals within them. And sometimes the size of the crystals make a very larger amount of the water droplets or the crystal size. And for the gravitational force, it is it gets into the lower atmosphere due to the gravitational force and couldn't melt down so easily. So it could be observed in a hail formation, which is called hailstorm. A large crystal balls could be observed in the ground level. Snowfalls are the tiny flakes of the snows, or the very light crystals of the particles, or which is called the neves, formed at the condensation level. So here the diagram describes that it's only the formation, it's only the water, the form of the water is changing, but it has a circular way. See over there, this is ocean, which is which has been evaporated to the to the atmosphere and condenses, create clouds, and then it precipitates as rain, formation of snow, and after that it has a surface flow. Surface flow as river or glacial movement, or it could be as groundwater movement, and again it meets with the ocean. So it's a circular way, which is termed as hydrological cycle. It's the circular process of transformation of the water molecule into the liquid, solid, or gaseous way. Now we have to study the condensation first. What is condensation? For condensation, we have to know one thing, that is humidity. The water vapor present on a specific amount of air is called humidity of the air. And the humidity of the air could vary from time to time and from space to space. There are some factors which will affect the humidity of the air. Number one, altitude. If there is a difference between the height of some places, then it should be the difference between the amount of humidity, amount of water vapor present in a specific weight or specific mass of air. So like if we have an example like Kolkata and Darjeeling, it should be obvious that there are some humid and arid type of temperature over there. We could say that some of the places of the earth is humid in nature, some of the places of the earth is arid in nature. So what is the basic difference? Like example, for example, Chennai and Delhi. So basically it's the two different location. I'm coming to the altitude, but another one is latitude as well. I'm giving the example of latitude. Chennai is located at the lower latitude or nearer to the equator, nearer to the equator, but Delhi is located nearer to the Tropic of Cancer, tropical area. So there must be a difference between the humidity. The Chennai will experience much more humid condition, but the Delhi, located at the interior portion of India, interior part of India, as well as nearer to the tropics, it will have a more temperate type of climate and climatic phenomena. The humidity will also vary. So altitude also have an example like Patna and Darjeeling. Patna is located in Bihar in a plain land, but Darjeeling is located in mountainous region. So as we all know, the cloud or the rain bearing clouds which obstructed by Himalaya, so obviously Darjeeling could have a much more humid condition because of several times Darjeeling receives rainfall in winter as well as in monsoon time. Patna, located in plain land, also receives humid condition, but in a slightly different way. Why? because due to the monsoonal wind only the Patna receives the humid condition. Otherwise, as Patna is located in a central position, nearly about central position and nearly on the Tropic of Cancer, so it will have a different condition and different situation for the humidity. Third one, is rate of evaporation. Now, the rate of evaporation will also affect the amount of humidity of a place. If there is a high amount of evaporation, now where the evaporation rate will be high, obviously it will be high near the equator or near the tropical region. So rate of evaporation will also affect the amount of humidity in the air. So these are some factors. Now, what are the specific temperature on which the state of the water changes? We all know about freezing point and boiling point of water, that is 0 degree Celsius and 100 degree Celsius. Both are extreme. The freezing point will be 0 degree and the boiling point will be 100 degree. So we could term the freezing point for condensation in different way. The specific temperature on which the gaseous state or the air could be saturated is called the dew point. The specific temperature on which the air saturated is called dew point. Now the question will arise, what is saturated air? There are two types of air. One is called saturated air and the another one is called unsaturated air. I am giving a basic example of what is saturation and what is unsaturation point. Saturation, I am having a cup of tea right now. So this cup of tea will have a maximum amount of sugar holding capacity. If I pour 5 spoons of sugar in a small cup of tea, then that will be maximum for the cup. If I exceed the amount, if I could pour the 6th spoon on the cup, then what will happen? The sugar will not dissolve. The maximum amount is the 5th spoon. So that is the saturation point. After that, it will be oversaturated. The sugar doesn't dissolve within the cup. So that is the saturated air as well. The amount of water vapor could hold in a specific amount of air, that is the saturation point, saturated air. After it couldn't hold the water vapor, it could precipitate. The amount of humidity will exceed, the amount of humidity will 100% on saturated air. But what about the unsaturated air? If I could pour in this cup of tea half a spoon of sugar, it will easily dissolve and could also able to dissolve more sugar within it. So that is the unsaturated one. While it could able to mix up more water vapor within it, the air is called unsaturated air. So the point, the temperature on which the air saturates is called the dew point. And may you have from this part a question like what is dew point and what is dew. Dew is another one and dew point is another one. Now dew is the form of what will be, is it precipitation or is it condensation? I think I must explain first and then it will be on you. Either it will be condensation, either it will be precipitation. The dew is a form which could be observed in atmosphere in a tiny water droplets. In the winter night or due to the release of heat, the temperature releases or the temperature cools down at the winter night or during the night time or autumn time. So the water vapor present in the air near the ground surface condenses. Actually the condensation process are relatively found in some portion of the higher altitude. As I have described already that the height decreases, increase of height decreases the temperature, which is normal lapse rate. But during the night time, during the winter time, the temperature already decreases in, into some point, so that the relative wind of that area could releases heat easily and becomes cool. So the condensation, the water vapor coagulates with each other, the particles coagulate with each other near the ground surface. The suspended particulate matter also coagulate or binds them with each other in the, near the ground surface. So the water droplets forms at the base level and it could be observed at the grasses or on the leaves of the trees, which is termed as dew. So this dew, is it we could say, is it condensation or is it precipitation? Precipitation is the process by which the water droplets fall from the high altitude to the ground surface. So the dew, the answer will be, the dew is the process of condensation. Another phenomenon of condensation is fog and smog as well. This phenomena also occurs at the winter time, at the early morning or at the night time, when the temperature releases quickly, the water vapor condenses near the ground surface. As the ground retains that availability or capability to specific temperature to form the water vapor into the water droplets. So while there is a suspended particulate matter, while there is a aerosols and industrial effluents in industrial areas, they could coagulate with each other, they will bind with each other and form a mystic situation. They form a veil-like structure near the ground surface. We couldn't see, we couldn't observe beyond 1 meter or 2 meter. It's very dense type of situation which is called fog, and whether the fog transformed more heavier situation, more denser situation, it will called as smog. The example of such smog could observed in an industrial area, in an industrial area like Durgapur city, Asansol, they could observe smog easily in the winter morning, early morning situation. So these are all the example of condensation. Now we have to know about the precipitation. Precipitation could be in the form of, mainly we could observe as rain, snow, snowfall, hailstorm, drizzle, and sleet. So this will be the main processes of precipitation. It will be discussed in the next video.